Coming up next on Gardener's Hotline, we'll be talking about invasive weeds in our yards and gardens. Stay right there.
From the studios on the Daytona State College East Campus.
Welcome to Gardener's Hotline. I'm your host, Karen Stauderman, a University of Florida Horticulture Extension agent. What's your favorite pastime in the garden? Weeding? Okay, I'm teasing. Most of us aren't fond of weeds, but we sure spend a lot of time and money trying to control them, right? Well, today's guest is an expert on weeds and all sorts of invasive plants. Meet Dr. Bob Stamps, a University of Florida horticulture professor at the Mid-Florida Research and Education Center in Apopka, Florida. Welcome to the show, Bob.
And Karen, it's a pleasure to be here.
Well, you know, Bob, I want to invite all of our viewers at home to join in the program today. Here's the number to call. Are you ready? It's 1-800-901-9238. Bob, we've got lots of questions on this subject. Tell me, what do you do at the Extension Center? At the Research Center?
I'm a professor of environmental horticulture, so I do research on how to grow plants and how to control plants when they get out of hand.
Okay. Well, that's like a big, tall order, especially when you've got weeds.
Right. But it's a lot of fun. We have a lot of interesting plants to work with.
All right. Well, let's get into it. You brought some great selections here. Tell me about some of them.
This red-leaved one here is a golden rain tree. It's just like many of our other invasive plants that we have here in Florida, were brought here because they look like a nice ornamental. Unfortunately, they just don't have the checks and balances to keep them under control here that they had in the countries they came from. The green one with the roundish leaves is the orchid tree, and that's another one. These plants, in general, produce a lot of seed, and they have mechanisms to disperse the seed so they can get out of hand.
Well, Bob, before we go, what is the definition of a weed technically? Well, how would you define it?
Well, a weed is a plant out of place. Basically, it's based on the person's interest in the plant and what they do with them. Here's a plant here. This is a fern that is an invasive plant. It's a Category 2 invasive plant. But we've been using this under controlled conditions to clean up contaminated water that has arsenic in it, or soil that has arsenic in it.
So that's a good plant.
It can be used for a good purpose, but if it gets out into the wild, then it can be invasive and cut and outcompete our native plants, reduce biodiversity, and inhibit the wildlife.
Okay, so that is also a definition of an invasive plant.
Invasive plants are ones that are actually disrupting our natural systems. We have we have many of these non-indigenous invasive plants, and then we have what we have in our yards in many cases are just nuisance plants.
What's the difference? How do you classify them? Or how does the state classify them?
Well, the state, it depends on how widespread they are, and if they are disrupting natural communities, they may get on the invasive plant list, the Florida Exotic Pest Plant Council invasive plant list.
And how many are on there?
Well, unfortunately, at this point in time, we have over 150 plants.
Wow.
That are at 77 that are known to disrupt our natural areas. And you're probably familiar with many of these. And then, for example, here's the Japanese climbing fern. We have the Japanese climbing fern.
Gee, Bob, and I thought the python was bad. Yeah. Now you're telling me plants are bad.
Right. This Japanese climbing fern is coming from the northern part of the state down to the southern part, and then down in the southern part of the state, we have the old world climbing fern that's moving north. And these ferns have fronds that can be over 100 feet tall. And they just crawl over other plants, exclude light, and disrupt and actually can kill the understory plants and trees.
Is there any animal that eats that?
There are in the countries that they came from, yes. And they're looking at finding those that we can bring here safely that will be specific to these types of plants. Biological control, in many cases, is the only way we're going to control many of these plants that have gotten out of hand.
I see. All right. This one with spikes. What is that one over there?
That's a sedge. And the sedges have triangular stems that are solid. And that's how you can tell if you've got a sedge. Many of them like wet conditions. We see them in the landscapes with people overwater. We see them brought in for water gardens, but as you can see on this plant, there's a lot of seed there already.
Yes.
And that seed can be spread by wildlife, by water, and then it disrupts our natural areas.
Does it make a pretty flower? Is that why we're confusing it with something that's valuable?
Not in this case. That one just has a striking form. It's a form factor. People use it in flower arrangements.
All right.
But it can get out of hand.
What about this one with the berries on it?
Well, this is our China berry. It's a tree that was brought here. It has very nice little purple flowers, and then it produces tons of seed, as you can see, and that gets spread by the wildlife. And you see this popping up in all of our natural areas and outcompeting some of our native plants.
Now, is it edible?
Well, the gentleman that was down here as a tourist that ate a lot of this and went back north and unfortunately perished, it's probably not a thing to eat, no.
So we don't recommend that.
No, we don't recommend the plant nor eating the fruit. No, not at all.
Now, you do have an attractive plant right here. I would love to see that in my flower arrangement. Now, tell me a little bit about it. It's invasive, so what is it?
Oh, extremely invasive. We've got tens of thousands of acres of this. This is Brazilian pepper, and we have, especially in many cases all over the state, along the coast areas, we have troops of pepper busters that go out there and try to remove this plant, because it'll form such dense hedges and thickets that none of the native vegetation will be there. And of course, the native vegetation evolved with our native wildlife, and that's what they can eat, and that's what they can reproduce on, say our butterflies and that sort of thing.
So our wildlife can't eat the berries off that, or can they adapt to that?
They can eat it. Unfortunately, they can eat the berries and then spread the seed.
Oh, okay.
And that's why it gets into all over the place.
All right. Now, you have another one up front. Now, this one has a lovely white flower. It looks similar to the China berry. What is it?
Yeah, that's Nandina, and that's a plant that there are some cultivars of this that are perfectly acceptable to use in the landscape. They are not known to be at all invasive, but there are some cultivars that are very weedy, produce seed, and also produce runners, and so they form these solid thickets again. If we could see the picture of the coral ardesia.
While we look for that picture of the coral ardesia, we've got a caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question tonight?
Well, if you have these invasive species like the Brazilian pepper and the golden rain tree in your yard, should you get rid of them? Should you cut them down?
Good question.
We have a very good friend that we visited, and I looked out the window and saw his Brazilian pepper tree, which he didn't know what it was. So in that case, we came back a few days later with a chainsaw and some Roundup, and we dispatched that tree before it could produce more plants. And it was weedy in his yard also, but it's also getting into wet areas, natural areas. So I would recommend getting rid of these. We're spending millions of dollars a year to control these plants. So, and one of the refugia for these are people's yards. We were at a nature preserve not long ago, and most of their invasive plants are coming from the next door development from people's yards.
Wow. Well, I think we have the coral ardesia up on the monitor. Tell me a little bit about it.
Okay, coral ardesia was brought in, another plant that has beautiful red berries. And it's forms these massive thickets. And as you can see in this illustration, this is an understory plant in a woods in another nature preserve. And it's essentially the only plant in the understory. It has just totally taken over, so none of the native vegetation's there anymore.
Okay. Well, we've got another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question tonight? Go ahead, caller. What's your question tonight?
Yeah, I want to know what kind of plants I can put outside there. I've put several different kind of plants out there, and because I get a lot of sun in the back, they literally fry my plants. And I water them, but still, they still just get fried.
Okay. There are publications out there, like this one, called Greener Choices, which list all of the plants that you can put, native plants you can put in the yard, and it gives an indication of which ones will do well in full sun, which ones are butterfly plants, which ones are suitable hosts for birds, and that sort of thing. So there are publications like this. If you go to the University of Florida, your extension office, they have publications that can give you a whole list of ideas of plants that will do well in that situation.
Right. And all that literature is free, and there's great selections out there.
That's right, Karen.
Yeah. Okay, now, Bob, we've got another one out in front that looks just like a fern. Now, I've seen them pretty enough in flower arrangements. Tell me a little bit about this one.
Yes. That's an ornamental asparagus. It's called Springeri fern. It's not a true fern at all. And this is one of the ornamental asparagus that is invasive because it does produce viable seed here. It produces red fruit, and those berries get eaten by animals and spread all over the place. So that's one that we don't recommend planting. There are other species like Ming fern, which is another ornamental asparagus, that do not produce seed here and are very attractive plants.
Oh, so those are great alternatives.
Yes.
All right. Looks like we've got potatoes here. Are you making mashed potatoes tonight?
Right. These are air potatoes.
Oh.
And that's that terrible vine that everybody just moans and groans about. How can we get rid of it? Many cases, these air potato roundups have worked extremely well by constantly removing the air potatoes, which have the seeds in them, then new plants don't come up. So if you kill the parent plant and then remove all of the seeds, then you can get the plant under control. But
now,
it takes a lot of time.
Let's remember, air potato roundup is not a chemical. You're talking about physically removing.
Right. That's where you get a group of people. They go out. They want to be outdoors, bring the kids, see who can find the most of them, who can find the biggest one, and that sort of thing, give out awards. But they have been very successful in many cases.
Now, how do they dispose of these once you have them? What can you do with them? You can't compost them. So what do? Throw them in the landfill?
You get them into a landfill. What we've done with some of our things, we bake them and make them just sterile.
Oh, how long do you bake them for?
Well, it depends on the size. You just have to bake them until they're done.
Are they edible?
That I don't know. I think they may be, but I'm not positive.
Wouldn't recommend it,
yeah,
probably.
Yeah.
We've got another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
My question is that in our community, we have trees with Spanish moss hanging, and I think this impedes the growth of the leaves and the trees. Should we get rid of it, and how?
Well, so you got me there. Spanish moss does not kill a tree. It can block some of the carbohydrates that it generates from photosynthesis. So generally what we recommend is that you take a garden rake and then just gently pull it down off the canopy of the tree and dispose of it. But it's a harmless plant, and it's an epiphyte, and it really won't hurt anything. And sometimes during our severe storms, it'll come down and you can pick it up. You can even bake it on a low oven and use it in flower arrangements.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to mention the flower arrangement usage.
Yeah. All right, Bob, now tell me a little bit about some of these smaller plants you have here up front. How about this one? Why does it have a red flag in it?
Okay, we'll talk about that one. This has a red flag in it because this is a federally and state-listed noxious weed. It's Bengal day flower. And what's interesting about this plant is that it's Roundup tolerant. So it's a big problem there. It's against the law to have the plant, so you're in violation of...
Hey, I didn't bring
yeah,
this.
Yeah, right. But it's a very interesting plant. We have a picture that we might be able to show that shows the underground flowers. It's one of only 50 or so plants in the world that has underground flowers. So as it sits there looking innocuous, it's producing seed underground.
It's a Bengal day flower is what we call this.
Right. And it can grow, it can root at every node on the plant. So if it gets hit by a mower, all you're doing is spreading it that way. It produces above ground flowers that produce seed that can be moved around. And apparently birds like the seed. They've looked at the gut contents of things like our mourning doves, and they're spreading it around. So it can pop up any place. You have to be constantly aware of it. You have to get it to it early because if it produces the underground flowers, those seeds will not be controlled by our typical pre-emergence herbicides.
Well, this is a nasty dude. All right. Well, tell me a little bit about this one. Now, I've heard about this one. Tell me a little bit about it and why it's so invasive and so serious to Florida.
Okay, well, let's look at both of these. This is our ragweed that everybody's probably familiar with. And this is our parthenium, which is ragweed parthenium. They look a little bit similar, and that's why this has a common name, ragweed. They're not related, Karen. But this is so bad, and it's a weed that's popping up more and more. If you go to stores and buy plants for your yard, you need to make sure that this is not in there. All parts of the plant are poisonous.
Wow.
The pollen is poisonous. It causes asthma, hay fever, bronchitis. If you touch the plant and handle it much, you can get contact dermatitis. If livestock or wildlife feed on the plant, if it doesn't kill them, it can taint the meat or the milk. It also produces chemicals. It's just a chemical manufacturing plant. And it produces these chemicals that inhibit other plants. So it's a threat to our biodiversity, and it just forms these massive monocultures.
Well, okay, let's say you have some of this. How do you know? I mean, if you get the skin dermatitis, does it go away?
Well, it will over time, yes.
Is it painful or just itchy?
Oh, it's itchy and all that. It depends on many factors, how much contact time, how you may not even get the dermatitis the first time around. It may take a while to get there.
So it's kind of like poison oak.
Yes, uh-huh, or poison ivy, you know,
wow.
That sort of thing. But let's go back to the Brazilian pepper. We have native plants, like I mentioned, that you can use to replace these. Our native holly, which we have a picture of, produces great masses of red berries. Also, our wildlife are adapted to that plant. It's a great plant to have in your yard. That's it. It's a great plant to have in your yard when the birds are migrating through. Many of our birds that eat insects, when they're feeding their young, when they're migrating, they don't have time to catch insects. There are not a lot of insects out certain times of the year, like in the spring when they're migrating, and so they eat the berries. So it's very important to our wildlife.
We've got another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question today?
Oh, my question is the chemicals that you can buy to get rid of some of these intrusive weeds. I was just wondering, I mean, it says don't eat any vegetables or any edible plant a year after. And how safe is that for the birds? You know, they might be flying around with three heads. I don't want that.
Right. She brings up a good question.
Right.
Mutation.
You don't want to do that. And that's not going to happen. In many cases, like I mentioned, the Brazilian pepper, you don't spray the whole plant. You cut the tree down, and then you just put a small amount of a non-residual herbicide, non-selective herbicide like Roundup. You just paint it just around the rim where the cambium is of the plant, and that's it. So there's nothing there for an animal to eat or to make contact with.
And so the active ingredient of that is glyphosate,
that's
right?
That's correct.
So look for glyphosate on the active ingredient on the herbicides, and you're halfway home free, but the cut has to be fresh, right? You can't wait.
Yes, you do it right away. Yeah, the sooner the better. So what we did was we had our glyphosate and a little brush there, and we just cut it and immediately painted it.
Cut it full strength from the herbicide.
Right.
Well, Bob, tell me a little bit of how we, in our landscape we would control some of these weeds.
Okay.
What are some of the methods you use?
Okay, the key to controlling weeds is to having a barrier there. Now, the barrier can be chemical, where you take a granular material.
What is this material, first of all?
This is our awesome University of Florida herbicide that has no herbicide in it. This is just our carrier we use for training. But you put that out, and it's important when you put any of these products out, whether it's a fertilizer or a herbicide or anything, you get a very even distribution at the correct rate. And you water that in with these pre-emergence herbicides, and that forms a chemical barrier right here. So if a weed seed starts to germinate, it kills that plant. Now, you can use other things. You can use a mechanical barrier, like these ground pack materials. This is not a solid sheet of plastic. This is a woven material.
It has holes in it.
Has holes in it, but they're very small. It allows water through. It allows air through, because it's very important that you have air going to the root system of your plants, as you know, because they're living organisms and they need oxygen. Mm-hmm. And then you can use your mulches, and you can use things like pine bark. We usually recommend about 2.5 inches of mulch. and that forms this dry layer that the seed, the weed seeds can't germinate on the top, and the weed seeds that are underneath it are smothered. And in fact, there are some weeds that the seeds that require light to enhance germination or
so cause germination. About 2 to 3 inches you'd recommend of mulch?
Yes, the pathologists like to keep it to 2 inches so it doesn't stay too moist, and some horticulturists like to go 3 inches, but 2.5 in that range does very well.
Now, does it matter if it's pine or cypress or melaleuca?
From as far as the weed control, there's not been shown to be a lot of difference. Pine bark is sustainable. Melaleuca is nice to get rid of a weed, you know, that so it's being ground up, and as long as it's weed seed free.
We've got another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question tonight?
Hello. My question is, how do I control Virginia creeper? The other name for it is woodbine. It's an invasive vine.
Doesn't it seem like every Floridian has that weed?
Right, and of course it's a native, and it's beautiful in the fall with those red leaves.
Yes.
And the berries, the best thing to do, and luckily it pulls down nicely. I have that in my landscape. If you can cut it off at the ground and then treat that stem with Roundup, or pull the vine down and roll it up, but don't disconnect it and treat it so it can the Roundup can translocate into the root system.
All right. We've got another caller. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question tonight?
Yes. My question is that I have a camphor tree or a bush in the corner of my property, and it's in a delicate place where I have my telephone line, and I have cut that thing down to the ground a dozen times, and it keeps coming back. Please tell me how I can get rid of this thing.
Hey, I'm glad you're doing that. Did you treat, after you cut it down, did you treat the stump?
She probably didn't, so that's probably a good thing to do.
Right, treat that with something like Garlon or Garlon triclopyr type product.
All right, and then treat it full strength. Don't dilute it.
Right.
And paint it on.
Paint it on.
Okay. Mm-hmm. We've got another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question tonight?
I've got 3 citrus trees. All of them have lost their leaves. The 2 orange trees, the leaves are starting to come back, but the grapefruit tree, nothing has come back yet, and yet the bark is good, or most of it is good.
Well, that's a good question. What I would recommend, first of all, is get a soil test. That's our annual checkup that we like to have homeowners do. Take a soil sample around the drip line of the tree, dig down about 6 or 8 inches, and send those samples off into the University of Florida Soils Lab, and your local extension office can help you with that. And then they'll give you back a diagnosis just in case perhaps your pH is off. Then from there, we'll get you started on a fertilizing program, or you can bring some photographs in or get some tissue tested at the University of Florida Plant Diagnosis Lab. That's a different lab. And they'll test it to see whether or not you have one of the unfortunate diseases that we have here on citrus, like greening, canker was another one. So these are some of the things that you need to get on rather quickly, because your tree should have leaves on them. So again, go to your local extension office, bring photos on your cell phone or email them into your extension office, and we can help you with that and get you on the road of recovery, or maybe suggest an alternative. All right, okay. Bob, last minute, tell me a little bit.
Could I just mention one thing here? One of the best things that everyone can do to control weeds and not have weed problems is to grow your lawn, grow your landscape well, have healthy plants. Most of the times we see problems, it's because there's a void. There's not enough mulch. The turf has some other issue. It's being overwatered, or it's got chinch bugs or whatever. So if you can keep your plants healthy in the landscape, they will help control the weeds.
Now, I know you have a special website that we've got on the monitor right now. Tell me a little bit about that, and is it easy to get to and understand? It should be on the monitor real soon. Tell me a little bit about that website.
Right,
this IVE?
Yes. www.ivegotone.org. If you're at all interested in invasive plants, you can go to this site, and you can find where every sighting of a python has been in Florida, or where all the Brazilian pepper is, or other invasive plants and animals. And you can report them there so that we can find out where they are, and then our cooperative invasive species management groups that are all over the state can get together and try to control them.
Well, that's a good way of doing it. Now, we can go online and enter the data ourselves, or do we make phone calls?
No, you can enter it yourself. You have to give information so that they can maybe contact you. There's a moderator that makes sure that people are not misidentifying something.
I see. Well, Bob, this hopefully we get a lot of calls tonight on this, and this is an open-ended topic. There's never an end to all these new invasive plants coming here to Florida. And hopefully we can get a handle on some of these. What is your what's your outlook on the weeds here?
Well, I think people are starting to understand that you don't just plant a plant because it's pretty. I'm not sure it's not going to be invasive. So by doing that and then by working together to get rid of what's here, we're okay.
Well, we're out of the end of the program already, and I'd like to thank my guest, Bob Stamps, for his insight in weeds and invasive plants. And I want to thank all of you for joining in today's program. Keep those emails coming, and if you didn't get your question answered, the email address is wdsc@daytonastate.edu. Join me next time on another edition of Gardener's Hotline.